everyone, and welcome back to our channel. This is the Elephant in the Room podcast, where we like to bring guests on and talk about all aspects of the unknown, the various mysteries of the universe. I am Ariel, and this is my amazing friend and co-host, Krys.
Hey, everyone. Welcome to the show.
And today we have a really special guest for you, someone that I'm really excited to introduce you all to. Today we have Doug Thornton, and he recently went with Christian ufologist Timothy Alberino to the Peruvian Amazon to investigate the alleged face peeler phenomenon that has been reported is going on down there. So we're really excited to have him on and talk to him about that and a bunch of other stuff, hopefully. Doug has his own YouTube channel, which is actually how I met him about 2 years ago or a year and a half ago, something like that. After I had done a real deep dive into the UFO phenomenon, and I had sort of determined for myself that I felt that this was real. I felt like there was, you know, definitely something to this, that we were being visited by non-human intelligence. You know, my next step was, okay, where do I go from here? You know, what is my next step? And for me, that meant exploring what this meant for my faith, my Christian faith. And so I started seeking out people who were in this space, other Christians who were in this space talking about this stuff. And I found Doug in his channel, and I really resonated with what he was saying. And I ended up reaching out to him, and we kind of got to know each other, and I had the opportunity to work with him on his channel for a very brief period of time. And although it wasn't a very long time, you know, working with Doug really gave me a boost of self-confidence, and it helped me to realize that I was on the right path with this UFO research and this content creation. So I'm really thankful to Doug and for his part in my journey. So a little background on Doug is he used to be in the military, and he has a background in law enforcement. And I believe that he currently runs courses that teach civilians like proper gun safety and how to navigate active shooter situations. And then he also has his YouTube channel where he talks about a lot of different topics. So without further ado, let's go ahead and bring Doug on.
Hey, welcome, Doug.
Welcome. Hello, so excited to have you on. How are you?
I'm doing great. I am very excited to be on with you. And I look forward to this conversation. Everybody has been asking me about Peru. And of course, it's pertinent about what's going on right now. But, you know, it's interesting timing because of the whole David Grush interview that he just put out with Joe Rogan.
Yeah.
Which I'm still analyzing. Because I don't know, some people like him, some people don't. I'm questioning him. And I'm not afraid to say that. Nothing against the guy, but it's against his motives. So, yeah, whatever you guys want to start with.
Yeah, so I think before we jump into the Peru stuff, which we want to get to in a second, could you just kind of tell us a little bit about yourself, your background, and how you became interested in the UFO phenomenon?
Yeah, so my name's Doug Thornton. I was a Marine Corps infantryman in 2006 to 2010, deployed to Iraq twice, was in Fallujah and Ramadi. I went back overseas as a contractor, came back home, and started delving into law enforcement. Did law enforcement for about 11 years. Last 10 was with the Department of Homeland Security. The last 4 or 5 of that was with our special response team side, where we dealt with all the riots that you guys are very aware of that mm-hmm. happened around the country, especially like in Portland, Oregon. And so from there, after January 6th happened, it wasn't too long after that I just kind of decided that the government was no longer for me because the government was no longer for us. Mm-hmm. And so I decided to leave. God led me on to having a position on gsradio.net, where I have a podcast. I created this crazy wild podcast story where I had absolutely no idea what I was doing, but I was just traveling in the direction the Lord told me to go to. My faith only grew leaps and bounds when I got taken out of my comfort zone and put into the wilderness. So I'm very grateful for that. My mm-hmm. time of testing has been very beneficial for me personally. And so you know, from there, I know a lot of these guys in the ufology field. A good friend of mine, Timothy Alberino. You know, we have had these discussions. I've been to Peru with them before. I've been on a few excavations that other guys have done before. I'm actually part of the Paleo Research Group. That's our own little group of guys where we are currently doing research into the mound builders of America and the giants that were around in America. So that's one thing that we're also doing. And we do a lot of cave exploration along with that. So, you know, the archaeology thing really is a big flare up of mine. And so this kind of all just mothballed together. And you asked, like, what got me really interested into the UFO thing? It was probably World War II, Nazi Germany, and the CIA and the disclosed declassified files since then. I'm kind of a history nerd. When I was going to college, I wanted to become a history teacher. And so that ended up not working out. So I ended up taking this love of history of mine and really delving into the white papers and declassified papers and the military history that we have. And it is a treasure trove of ufology that I like more to go down that route, mainly because it, for someone who worked for the government for over 15 years, and I see our government meddling with these things, the MK Ultra, the Mockingbird, the JFK assassination, all this crazy stuff that's going on. And then you throw in UFOs and come to find out, we have really been about UFOs for a long time, since 47, 48. And carrying over, you have a lot of the, after Project Paperclip, Operation Paperclip, you have a lot of carryover from the Nazi scientists who came over here to America, who continued to do all these different experiments that all had to do with some sort of aviation. For the most part, it was led by aviation, much like the Luftwaffe was led by aviation. That's why you got these horrific concentration camp stories. Well, if you keep going further, the ufology then turns into a deep set of occultism. And I mean, ufology and occultism are the same thing. They're just two people not talking to each other in the same room, but it is definitely adjoined. And so, you know, once I started to really figure out the occultism side, I have just been drawn in ever since. And I'm you know, a kid enough to believe that there are things out there I can't explain, and it's still fun to try and, you know, theoretically, mentally go after it. But when you look at the white papers of what the government's been doing and all the conspiracies and all the cover-ups, and then, you know, you have ATIP that comes out. You have a Project Blue Book in 1994 when it was finally closed by the U.S. the U.S. Air Force. They said that there was no threat and that there was only maybe 1,000 cases altogether, 1,800 cases, I think, that they investigated. And out of all that, there was like 2-3% that they kind of said, nah, we'll give you that one, right? Like, maybe there's a UFO there. But they said there's definitely no threat, no threat. And then fast forward about 15 years, and now we have ATIP. And in between that time frame, you have Skinwalker Ranch. You have $23 million worth the government invested in a Skinwalker Ranch, not because of paranormal stuff, because of UFOs. Like, that just needs to be said. Not because of the crazy paranormal stories, which are very fun to listen to. I've driven up to the gate of Skinwalker Ranch. If I was allowed access, I would go there right now and investigate it. But
there's the answer to your question, Ariel.
Yeah, it's so funny because before we started, I told Krys, I said, we have to ask him about Skinwalker Ranch because I know that he has been dying to get on the ranch. I remember you and I talked about that when we first met. You told me, Ariel, I'm dying to get on that ranch and investigate for myself. So you still feel that way then, huh?
Absolutely. You know, like the same way that we did this investigation in Peru, I approach things from a law enforcement perspective. So I want hard data. The science guys that are out there at Skinwalker Ranch right now and all the experiments that they're doing, and they're getting a lot of data from it. But it's almost just turned into like an eighth grade science project. Mm-hmm. Hey, let's see if we launch some more rockets in the air, what happens? And I get it. They do it and some phenomena happens, but I would like to see more done. And I don't know what all I could contribute, but I would contribute anything and everything. There's already a few cops who are working there. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we have the right temperament and mindset to get in there and to try and flush something out. I'm not afraid to sit inside a house that's on site two or whatever, homestead two, and see what happens. I'm not afraid. I'm solid in my faith. I know Christ will protect me, but there's something that's out there. And I personally believe Skinwalker Ranch has some sort of a principality about it. I think Skinwalker Ranch has way more paranormal than there are other things that's going on. But yet then you have the UFO sightings. Mm-hmm. And so a long time ago, I was listening to the Audible book of Hunt for Skinwalker. And I was reading the book at the same time. Fantastic book. If no one's ever read it, fantastic book. Mm-hmm. So this is what really tipped the scales. My wife and I, we went on vacation. We're coming home and I'm listening to Hunt for Skinwalker. We get home and I remember we're laying in bed and I just turned to her and said, man, wouldn't it be weird if we had a cattle mutilation out in the back pasture where all of our cows are? Go to work the next day. About midday, I get a phone call. Something's wrong with one of the bulls in the back. Immediately, in my mind, I'm going, you got to be kidding me. Mm-hmm. You've got to be kidding me. My neighbor's out there messing around with it. My wife's saying something happened. And she's kind of freaking out. So I'm freaking out. I let my boss know. I was like, hey, something's happening at the house. I got to head home. So I get there and come to find out the ear is perfectly cut off. And I got all the pictures. The ear is perfectly cut off. The sexual organs are missing. The body was exsanguinated. So there's no blood. There's no abrasion. There's no lacerations. There's no cut wounds. There's no bite marks. There's no penetrating wounds from like a stab or, like a bullet entrance. We did a full carcass evaluation on it. I did it. And then we had our veterinarian friend come out here, who's a cattle veterinarian. He did a full carcass evaluation. And he himself said, I have no idea. But his mind went exactly where mine did. I didn't ask him. I said, what do you think, doc?
Influence him.
Yep. And he just kind of looked at me and said, I'm not going to say it's aliens. but we're like, yeah, we're like, come on, man, what's going on? See, me, I still fall into the line of, because you cannot take away the satanic occultism that's happening within our areas. It doesn't take 5 minutes of Googling and research to know that from Oklahoma to DFW down to Waco, there are numerous witches covens and there are numerous amounts of cattle mutilations that have happened in the area where they take the tongue, the eyes, they take the sexual organs, they take the blood and they use it in sacrifices. However, that being said, this was all done during the day while my family was in the back.
Also, wouldn't those things be different types of lacerations? And I mean, I don't know, but I'm assuming that if what, a witch is taking a body part, it's going to have a different laceration.
Most of the time, these things are done in the time of night during darkness, when most of the time you have criminal activity afoot. And how you take down a 1,000-pound steer that won't let you around it. And I don't know. In my mind, I'm like, the thing won't come to you unless you lay pellets out and then it'll come eat. Even then, it always keeps a healthy distance. I don't know. Maybe someone tranquilized it, right? Now the problem is we have to start inserting what ifs and maybes and possiblies. And all that does is it just adds to a phenomena we can't understand. It helps us to break it down, but it doesn't help us really to analyze it better. And I'm still 50-50. I'm 50-50. I don't know how to explain it, but I know it's like during the day that's very brazen. And why did it happen in the only cop's backyard, back pasture. And literally, I was listening to Skinwalker Ranch.
Right.
And that night, I said, wouldn't it be weird if we woke up and there was a cattle mutilation and all things happened? So I still kind of lie more on the paranormal, occultism, demonic side to that. But I say that the two are conjoined. That's my personal opinion. I think the two are very much conjoined, somewhere at the hip. These entities talk to each other, know each other. I don't know. I don't get it. But I don't believe in coincidences. I'm a very pragmatic person. I'm driven by data. I'm driven by what I see. And, you know, in our area alone, there's 13 witches covens. In our area alone, when Parker County, Texas is considered to be the paranormal hotspot of Texas. So most amount of UFO sightings, Bigfoot sightings, like haunted houses, right? So there's something here to the effect of this area. Oh, also a giant Comanche burial ground. So there's a lot going on here, and I think it adds up to it. You know, that's been my experience so far. I wanted to chase down the whole cattle mutilation thing because
that's huge.
That is very, very intimate to me now.
Can you clarify for me when you say it's related, you're saying that because there is occultic practices in your area, you believe that that's linked to this event potentially? Am I likening that to your belief maybe that there are principalities and powers and different things like that in different areas? Is that kind of what you're saying?
Well, that's absolutely true. That's absolutely true.
Okay.
No, what I'm saying is there's a definite link somewhere between the occultism, satanic ritual abuse, and the UFO stuff. There's a link. People don't want to admit it because then you burst their bubble of, well, it's not little green men who seeded us here on the planet. If you want to swallow rocks for a living, go ahead. I don't believe in that type of garbage. But
now we have a lot of different audience members on our podcast and experience.
Here's what's weird.
I have to hear you out because I'm curious to what your beliefs are. But at the same time,
let me say it like this. I love you the same way Jesus loves you, right? I don't look down upon anyone for any experiences. I think some people have seen more than others. Some people are looking harder than others. And until led to certain things, you believe something that maybe you used to not to. That was me way back in the day. I didn't believe in almost anything unless I couldn't see it, touch it, then it didn't exist. And then other events happened. But here's where I draw in the line is that you have the works of Dr. Stephen Greer, who has, you know, I think helped the UFO community. Some people have different varying degrees of opinions on him. I really care not. But when he does his CE5s, I think that's what it is, CE5s. And you sit in the Indian style position and you meditate and poof, there's a light up above. And that's you know, your aliens. As a Christian and as someone who's a minister, I'm going to tell you that that is not what you think it is, but there are things out there that will be ready to answer your question the moment you cast it out into the ether. And so you have to test the spirits. I think some of the things that Stephen Greer saw were absolutely demonic. However, on the adverse, the old white papers that he's pulling up, the technology from Tesla, a lot of the experiments that the U.S. government and others have done, and then the nuts and bolts crash craft with the crashes with the humanoid entities that were inside these beings. Like, I don't deny that.
Right.
I don't deny that at all. I'm solid enough in my faith to say I can't explain everything, but I do believe this phenomenon is happening. I do believe somewhere along this crazy line, there's a connection in between all of it. And some people get way too caught up in it. And then, you know, they just, what happens when you get too caught up into this is that what the problem with absolutism is that you don't leave room for the what if and for reality. And when something really traumatic happens to you and you say, look, UFOs are just, you know, they're just a star in the sky that falls. And that explains why UFOs. Until one lands in your backyard, right? Until you see the little gray being inside your room at night. Mm-hmm. Until the government comes out and says, oh, hey, by the way, for about 70 years, mm-hmm. we know it's real. We've been a part of it. Oh, and by the way, the CIA also helped to stage abductions, faking UFO alien abductions. And it was absolutely them that staged it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's some interesting correlations here. And I don't buy everything that everyone tells me. And so mm-hmm. that's why I tell people, do your research. Pray about it. Pray about it. Do your research.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think that, I think you can say what that about a lot of things. I think you can extrapolate various experiences based on your faith, and you can also extrapolate it based on experiences and data and yeah, I don't know. I just think you're right that you can't be too dogmatic about it because no one really knows.
Yeah, there's a lot of mystery to it. There's a lot we don't know. And there's, you know, we are even as Christians, you know, we're coming at that from, you know, Krys is more of a deconstructing Christian. I'm more of like your traditional evangelical Christian. Krys, you know, she's more of like in the process of sort of deconstructing. Is that, am I?
Yeah, I'm a total, I've come a long way from my faith, to be honest. And
the UFO thing has been part of that, right? Like, cause you
honestly, I think that reality is that it's probably drawn me back a little bit more than it's made my curiosity return to questions of my faith more than mm-hmm. it has turned it away. So mm-hmm. I was deconstructing my faith for years before my UFO experience. But, and I say deconstruction, you know, whatever, that's just a term people use to talk about, you know, where they're at currently. Mm-hmm. If they've questioned some of their own, programming and belief systems of various people throughout their life, you know, not just Christianity or the church or any of those things. But yeah, as a former youth pastor and, you know, church house planner and a lot of things, this is just one more mystery to me. And I guess and for me it has, you know, it takes me back to those questions in the Bible and those stories where, you know, principalities and powers, and I understand that. I also look at angels and demons, and I also look at just various other phenomena throughout history. Mm-hmm. And I don't land in one place at this point in time. Anyway, mm-hmm. enough about me.
Yeah, you know, the problem that I see currently is that the church doesn't have a good response to the alien question, the UFO question.
Right.
And then when you don't have a good response, and for one thing, if you're not studied in it, and this is not a topic that people, you know, they go to college and get their theology license and, you know, the alien religion, you know, dogmas, but
right.
You have to understand the subject matter. For me, you know, I do a lot of, I want to say investigations, but I'm doing a lot more now into satanic ritual abuse and occultism, of which the church also is not prepared to talk about and does not want to talk about it because many in the church are involved in it. Mm-hmm. So just like how there's many sitting in the pews right now who've seen aliens, as what they claim to be, who have been visited in the night by things they can't explain, some who are abductees and some who have seen UFOs. I've known a couple cops who even whenever I wasn't really big into this conversation, you know, here I am 12, 13 years ago, listening to, you know, Coast to Coast AM, and I'm listening to, you know, UFO stuff. And a buddy of mine, when I was working up in Philadelphia, he came up and said, you know, Doug, one night I was, you know, on patrol, and he was up in the back country of like Allentown. And he said a flying saucer landed in the middle of the highway at like 2 a.m. No one's there. And I don't remember anything. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, there are similar stories of abductions that have happened like that. And you get this time gap that's missing, this missing time. Mm-hmm. And you only have relative amounts of information that you can recall. And, you know, working with Timothy Alberino, I've learned a little bit more because this is more of his cup of tea. But I think that the cat's out of the bag with the government. This is a real event. These are mm-hmm. real events. We're not lying about it no more. Mm-hmm. And so I think the church, along with law enforcement, they need to start getting their act together, because more people are going to come and say, I've been abducted. I've seen things. I want answers. And law mm-hmm. enforcement is going to say, I don't know how to write that statement, but take me from A to B. And then your ministers, your preachers, your pastors, they're also going to have those conversations with their parishioners. And they're going to say something very similar, as in, how much narcotics were you on lately?
Right.
Do you normally hallucinate? What's your mm-hmm. mental state? Just, you know, what's your family life like? And
you're going straight to hell could be an option too for that one. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, we're
conversation.
You're creating a cop out for a phenomena that's happening. It's happening. Mm-hmm. You know, it's the same thing with the child sex trafficking. No conversations to be had about that. But there are high-ranking members of law enforcement, the government, and mm-hmm. in churches that are involved in it. So those same people who don't want to talk to you about UFOs, or the same people who don't want to talk to you about domestic violence, they don't want to talk to you about child trafficking, they don't want to talk about sex trafficking. But when the government comes around, you make sure you do what they tell you, though. You know. So, I've learned to question quite a bit. I'm kind of a rogue when it comes to pastoring. God told me a long time ago to preach the word to the young men like me. Guys are, you know, in their mid-40s and down, and to get the word out there to raise men back up to that warrior priest mindset. And with that, there's gonna be a lot of conversations that men have to have, so that when, you know, people are asked, well, you know, there's UFOs all over the TV right now, do not fear. Do not panic. Mm-hmm. And do not be deceived. The things that Christ said, that is how it should be applied. And if we don't get out there and we don't say it, then you're going to have everyone else out there, from the occultism to the people who believe in panspermia and all this other stuff. I say, oh, nope, there's our saviors right there. So mm-hmm. as a Christian, I have to say that as like a forewarning that, you know, there's going to be a coming time of testing for people's faith.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so, you know, that's why I really get into the UFO topic.
I'm gonna ask a really practical question this is one of those things that, what do you mean, don't be deceived? Isn't the act of deception not something you have control over? I'm just being really honest, because I feel like that's something that's always, you know, one of the things that I've heard for, actually, when you say the church doesn't have an answer for it. I mean, I was studying 20 years ago, and before I was into ufology, I heard a whole series on it by Chuck Missler, which to me is a very interesting side anyway. But he was talking about don't be deceived, and, you know, it's gonna, and the scripture talks about don't be deceived. What if you're deceived? You don't have a choice. So how do you apply that practical knowledge to don't be deceived when the act of deception is something that is somebody else is doing to you.
So that is where we're to be strong in our faith and strong in the word of God. The act of deception means that there's a lie upon us, right? So that means that there is a means for that lie to be committed. So there's an end goal here. The end goal is to deceive you, to turn you away. And the end goal is for the father of lies, Satan, is to always turn you away from the salvation of the cross. There, do not be deceived. So everything and anything that tells you the salvation of the cross of Jesus Christ is not sufficient is a deception. Okay. So if the scientists come out and say, well, we've got these 4,000-year-old mummies of aliens that must be our original people. Okay. For one thing, that's not where we came from. Bible clearly states where we came from. Don't be deceived. I'm going to say something right now that's probably going to get you guys a lot of hate mail. Flat earther.
It's okay.
This is what we want.
This is your opinion. Then we're here to listen and share. Yeah. We're okay with that.
Yeah. This is what we.
It doesn't mean I agree with you.
Yeah. No. And this is what we want. We want to have a variety of opinions. We want to have people on here, you know, talking about what they believe. So yes, please. Like we want to hear what you think.
So I get a lot of hate mail from a lot of people that are flat earthers. I love you the way Christ loves you. Okay. I don't care about flat earth at all. It does nothing for my salvation, but you have people who will literally tell you, Doug, you don't believe in biblical cosmology. You're going to hell. You don't believe the real words of God. Right. Why? Because I don't believe in flat earth. Okay. Insert. You're going to hell.
The biblical cosmology has a sphere. He hung the sphere from the heavens. I don't understand how a flat earth is biblical cosmology. Anyway.
Don't worry. You're going to get an email and they're going to explain it to you. The problem lies in this. It's not the theory that these people are stumbling for, because there is a stumbling stone that's been put in front of them. And it's this theory. In 1st and 2nd Timothy, it talks about going after knowledge and seeking after knowledge and not being satisfied and seeking out new teachers, and they will satisfy you, because God will give you over to what your heart desires. If the cross isn't sufficient for you, then God will give you what your heart desires. He'll give you over to it. You'll be reprobate. All right. So the problem really lies in the militancy of these people. I deal with them quite a bit. And I actually have a few friends of mine who are flat earthers, and we have a completely honest, good, nice conversation. And then you have others that I find are kind of the higher percentage of the others that are very militant. And what you see is you see a captured mind. You see a mind that's captured, and there is a deception there. When you have to try and convince me. Yeah, when you have to try and convince me of your theology to the point that anything anyone else says militantly wise is wrong, you've got a pride problem. So once again, with a lot of these deceptions, once you get caught into it, then your pride gets brought into it because, well, I'm fully involved in this. I've done hundreds of hours of YouTube research, and I ask people, how much of that have you done on your knees? How much have you done in scripture? Did you ask God about it? Did you seek the Lord's face? And they'll tell me, no, but watch this YouTube video. I don't need a YouTube prophet. I don't need that. So that's one of many deceptions. And I believe that our government is part of the father of lies children. I think we have a whole closet full of deceptions that we have not unveiled yet. That is to be unveiled soon. And I do believe that the whole UFO thing is a part of it. I'm not going to say UFOs are demons. I don't believe in that. UFOs are the disembodied spirits of giants. So anyone who says a UFO is a demon is not reading their Bible, and they're just listening to people on YouTube. Read your Bible. That's not what it says. Okay. The other part of this is that...
I know that this is totally off. I just need to clarify real quick because I'm shocked and obviously I've not done my research. Wait, is flat earth thing a thing in Christianity? Is that like a common...
Don't worry, you're going to get an email about it.
No, it's not. I don't think it's super, it's not super common in evangelical Christianity. It's still fringe.
Is it fringe?
It's very fringe. It's okay.
But I didn't know it was a Christian fringe thing. I knew it was
a belief,
but I didn't know it was a Christian fringe belief.
Oh yeah, there's a whole sect of people out there that one day when they get to heaven, they're going to be given an option. And this is my sarcasm, okay?
Not very welcome.
You're going to see Christ, and he's going to say, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant. The earth is round." And then they're just going to say, "Point me to hell, because that's the way I want to go. If the earth can't be flat, I don't want to be here no more."
Send him the hate mail, not us.
Oh my gosh, Doug, you're ridiculous, but I love it.
People take themselves too seriously. Don't be that way around me.
I know. The thing I want to say is, you know, as a Christian, I agree with searching the scriptures and I agree with being on your knees and asking God to see if, but the problem with that, and you know, I agree with that, but when you look at theologians all throughout history, you know, they were talking about, you know, this is what they did. They studied the scripture. They were on their knees. And all of them have come to different conclusions regarding so many different topics. You know, there's very few, you know, there's like the core doctrine of Christianity. And then there's all these other things that theologians have disagreed on. So I don't know. I think there's just maybe some things that like God is okay with us not being for sure on. You know, obviously there's the core doctrines, but I also think we have to be careful saying like, be on your knees and be praying because God's most definitely going to like reveal to you what's real and what's not real. Because when you look at all of these different theologians, well, they all thought that they were right, clearly, but like if they're disagreeing, then you know, 99% of them weren't.
The issue here with theologians is that many theologians have turned themselves into be no different than the Sadducees and Pharisees of the Hebrew time. Mm-hmm. They study to show themselves approved, but where is their faith? Mm-hmm. Where is their faith? Look at all the different doctrines that we have right now.
I mean, there's also a lot of fear in the church. I'm just saying, a lot of fear. And where's your faith? I mean, that's what I feel. I feel like a lot of my upbringing in the church was fear-based and just caused so much anxieties and so much negativity and just constant, you know, just feeling, I mean, that's feeling of defeat. It was not,
there which was is no, not from Christ.
Right. There was no faith, right? That's just pure fear.
The issue is that much of what is echoed in the church is not preached in the trenches. They won't take that cushy, sugar-filled Christian message down to Skid Row. They won't take that into the prisons. They'll keep it, you know, they'll keep it out there in the area where you can wear your slacks and your freaking, you know, shiny shoes and your it's the word of God is supposed to be preached in a way that a common man can understand. And Jesus specifically said, come as you are. And for someone who does not look like your average guy who talks about God, I was rejected quite a few times going to churches. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, the church has hardened its heart in many ways. The body is so divided.
Yeah.
Divided, divisive, stiff-necked, hardened their hearts. They have only enough faith to sit in the pew and to read the Bible and maybe sing a few songs, and they don't have enough faith to not watch pornography when they leave, or to not commit adultery, to not steal, to not lie, to not murder, to not covet. But yet all these other things, you know, that we've talked about, don't insert that into our biblical message for the day. Now, you shouldn't be overshadowed and overtaken by UFOs and all this right. other stuff when you're in the church and you're ministering to people. But it is a topic that will yeah. be approached, that has to be yep. approached.
Yep.
And it needs to come from people who are spiritually minded, who are, as I say, keeping the conduit open between you and the Lord, but also are very pragmatic and not dogmatic. Yeah. Because what we have is man-made religion that yeah. follows the Bible instead of man following the Bible. That's my problem.
Well, that's a huge barrier, I think, to overcome. I think it's a huge barrier for society to overcome in the first place, and how to have these conversations with people yeah. in general, clearly. And I think that just the onus on the church is going to be 10 times heavier to be able to,
well, and
to have people, those conversations without stigmatizing people and shaming them and these other things that's gonna happen, you know, that could potentially happen if you're not prepared to have a good conversation with somebody.
And I was gonna say that, absolutely. So being on Twitter, one of the most common messages I get, because I have in my bio that I'm a Christian and then I'm into the UFO phenomenon, and one of the questions that I get over and over and over again is, hey, Ariel, I found your page. I'm, you know, either I am a Christian or I'm not a Christian, but I am so curious how you as a Christian approach this UFO topic. Like, I'm just so curious how you link. And so as a Christian, I want to be able to have an answer for that, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, when I say seek God first about these things, there's never not a wrong time to seek God first. And who is out there that is a man that could say that God would not give you revelation about these things? Because these people, by the way, they seek another and they are given information, like the Nazis. Right? Where'd you get all your technology from? Oh, aliens gave it to us. Really? Mm. Is that why you're in the Vervable Castle and you're chopping dudes' heads off and doing orgy seances? Because the aliens told you? See, there's a connection here, all right? And, like, what is it? From NASA to the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, like, the Babylon Working, I think that's what it was, Babylon Working. You have a lot of occultism, of occultism tied into this whole UFO thing. And that needs to be talked about more, but it's not approached, because when you approach it, when you approach occultism, like, let's say we're coming at it from the UFO side, we're trying to figure this one side out. You're quickly going to see the fingers are pointing over to this side, which is child sacrifice, which is Jeffrey Epstein Island, which is Pizzagate. And then you start going, why do these two connect each other? Because there's a connecting force there. And for many people that are atheists, that are agnostic, they don't see that side because they're not seeing the spiritual aspect of this. But if there's not a spiritual aspect to this, then why is Stephen Greer out in the middle of a forest humming to himself and thinking, I want to see an alien, I want to see a craft, and poof, there they are. Is that how technology works? No.
But is it necessarily spiritual? Could it not be a form of communication? I'm just throwing it out there. I mean,
so I will gladly go with that.
Prayer, contemplation.
I'll gladly tell you that ESP is a real thing.
Okay.
Because I
believe that too. I feel like I've experienced it for sure.
Yep. Project Grill Flame. Look up Project Grill Flame.
Okay.
And look at what the CIA and the DIA and the DOD were doing, which involved inviting a witch in so that she could do occultic practices.
Okay.
ESP is a real thing. The whole telepathy stuff is a real thing. Before there was a Cold War, between World War II and the Cold War, we had the Psi War.
Right.
Russia at one point in time said that they had the Red Witch, was a woman who could look at you and stop your heart. And either this was a very clever form of counterintelligence and propaganda, or it was something that was real that we couldn't explain, but we thought it paralleled enough that we did it ourselves. Out in Fort Detrick, Maryland, there was an entire company of guys that all did the ESP stuff out in California. There was a college foundation that was involved in the ESP stuff. So, are there things that we can tap into as humans that the average person can't, and then have abilities that we can't explain, that people aren't going to believe you, by the way, that can't explain it? Yes. The Chinese were doing their own type of experimentation with children, along with working with the CIA back in the 70s, 80s, might have been 70s. And they had up to 25 children. I have all the documents, by the way, because I'm a history nerd and I read them all.
Here, I'm like, he probably would love that I have this book on my
head. I have that book right behind me. Oh yeah, I got that book right behind me.
I just haven't read it yet. Ariel.
I have an entire, I have a library filled full of these books. but the Chinese were working with 25 children who could control objects to one child. And I've seen the documentation, which is just, I don't know how to explain what I'm seeing when I see it, but it's still shot photos of a child reaching into a glass jar, fingers penetrate the glass jar, grabs an object and pulls it out of the glass jar. And it's still shots. And there's a big write-up about it.
I heard you talk about this one time on another podcast, and you had linked that document in the YouTube description, and I went and I looked at the documentation. So I know exactly what he's talking about. These children had these incredible abilities, and you know, my husband is a total skeptic, and I showed it to him and I'm like, look, like this is actual documentation that Chinese doctors, like they saw these children doing these extraordinary things. Like it was, I mean, like you said, there's no way to explain it. How do you explain that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't have an explanation.
Do you believe that all those abilities are related to the occult or to demons or to Satanism? Or I mean, do you think they're human abilities? They're extrasensory perception, exactly what it is. Abilities that we may have as physical humans that are not spiritual.
Well, for one thing, we are all spiritual beings trapped in a fleshly body. So there are things that we can do. I mean, man, I could tell you the stories about people lifting cars off of each other, about a guy who fell over 100 stories during an avalanche and broke both his arms, both his legs, from feet to the tibia to femurs, broke his hip, broke part of his back, and then walked 4 miles because a voice told him, get up, climb out. And when he climbed out of this avalanche, 100 stories, that is the Empire State Building. He fell off of a mountain along with hundreds of tons of snow. And his partner, unfortunately, had died. They were climbing partners. They were more or less just, two guys who lived in their car, and they traveled from park to park climbing mountains and then worked like, you know, odd and end jobs. Mm-hmm. But, you know, this guy, he had one of these encounters with a person. He claimed to have been a woman. They call this the third man event, I think. And he had a woman who was dressed as a hiker. She came out of nowhere, said, you need to get up, you need to put your jacket on, you need to stand up, use your left arm that's not too broken, and grab on that tree branch, grab the tree branch, take your water out, take some sips of that water, and you need to get up and start walking. Okay.
Whoa.
He did 4 miles of an entirely broken body, which should not have been possible, even with adrenaline. Eventually, the injuries itself will kill you. But the human body is an amazing thing.
Right.
So he was guided by this spirit guide, of which you can't explain. Now, I'm comfortable enough to say, I don't know what I don't know, but I'm also wise enough to say, I don't discount what people tell me in their witness testimony. Okay. Right. I can't prove it, but I'll hear you out. Right. And eventually you start to hear a similar pattern across the board of, we just can't explain this.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I live my life. It's so much simpler for me now. people say, Doug, do you think vampires are real? Sure. Werewolves? Of course. Mary Shelley's Frankenstein? There's probably two of them. Probably. I can sleep comfortably at night if someone told me yesterday that Frankenstein, Dracula, and a werewolf broke into somebody's house. I'm going to say, you know what? I believe that. I believe that. Absolutely. Whatever.
I'm at that point now, too. I didn't realize it a year ago, but I might be there now.
Oh, by the way, the government says aliens are real. Remember the thing they used to laugh at you about? Now they're saying it's real. No, so that's my twisted mindset of that.
Well, can we like rewind a little bit and talk a little bit about the Peru expedition? Because that was like, that was a 50-minute, you know, diatribe. I loved it. But I also want to make sure that we cover the Peru stuff because I know that people want to hear your perspective on everything that happened. So I listened to the debrief video that you and Tim did. And yeah, I just want to dive into a little bit more of the details. Kind of, you know, he talked a lot and you talked a little bit. And I just kind of want to pull some more details out of you. But first, take us back to like the origin of the expedition and how did it come about? And when did you realize that this was going to be part investigation and part humanitarian?
Well, this first started with the incident that happened in Vegas. Alberino and Dave Hodges and myself were all covering this event that just happened in Vegas, where you had a supposed craft that had landed in these people's backyard. Mm-hmm. And then all the conspiracies and whatnot happened after that. And then within a month, you have this event that happens in Peru. Okay. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, you get the whole face peeler thing. Well, Timothy and I are Googling our hearts away of, you know, trying to find out what the heck is going on. I'm looking at every Reddit forum chat that I can find. And we come across this guy who, you know, he's had half his face completely peeled off. And it's bizarre looking. It doesn't look real, but then again, it's hard to fake a dead body. So I don't know. The cop in me says something's weird here. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's criminal activity afoot, as we would say. I had reasonable suspicion to think that something's not right about this video. So within a week, you have these videos that come out from San Antonio de Pintiacu of this girl who was attacked and, you know, almost had her face ripped off by an alien. And then there's all these, you know, really grainy footages of people with their flashlights and shooting shotguns into the woods. Mm-hmm. And I'm just like, the whole time I'm watching this, I'm like, is this like a bad rerun of like Predator? What is going on right now?
Yeah.
And so I didn't really know what to think about it. We covered it. Tim kind of took over that because Tim for 10 years lived in the Amazon. Mm-hmm. And in this area that we were at, he actually has land out in Tarapoto.
Mm-hmm.
But in this part of the Amazon that we're at, he lived there for 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he was with these people. He spoke the dialect perfectly.
Mm-hmm.
And Doug is as gringo gets. I know habla Espanol. I know just enough to get myself in trouble. Like, I know just enough Spanish for someone who speaks Spanish to go, oh, let me continue with a more complex conversation. Like, no, I don't understand what I'm saying.
Me too.
I worked on the border for a little bit, and that's where I picked up my Spanglish. So it is not helping me. We're at a dig site in Arkansas with the paleo research group.
Okay.
And so Tim calls me. We're actually back at the hotel. Tim calls me, says, hey man, that video you and I did like a week ago is almost at like 900,000 views.
Oh wow.
I'm like, what?
On the Peruvian?
Yeah. Oh, wow. On the whole Peruvian alien thing. And so I'm a little bitty guppy in this big YouTube pond. All right.
Yeah.
Tim is just barely bigger than me. All right. Yeah. Barely. Right. Only a couple hundred thousand more people than me.
Well.
And so Tim's never had anything on his site that reached 1 million in a week. Obviously, I have not.
Mm-hmm.
And so we were both really perplexed, and Twitter was going crazy with it. And we're like, man, me and Tim were laughing because we were like, we were actually almost kind of bored talking about this. we were like, hey, you know what? I don't know what we're going to talk about tonight. Let's bring up the Peru thing. And we spent an hour on it. We didn't prepare one bit for it. We're like, yeah, we'll just shoot the breeze and talk about this. And it just went out of control.
Yeah.
And so we're like, okay, there's something here. There's a yearning for this information.
Yeah.
Well, then Tim gets reached out to from a guy named Christian. Christian is the high school teacher that is at this village. And so he reaches out and says, hey, man, I've got more information for you. And so starts to converse with Tim. And it wasn't too long after this when we're out here and we're doing an archaeological dig in northern Arkansas. And I'm at the hotel room. Tim calls me, says, hey, man, that video is almost at 1 million. I think we need to go to Peru.
Wow. And
my first thought and the first thing I told Tim was, well, you have fun with that. I don't want to go back to Peru. And so, you know, I prayed about it, talked with my wife about it, and, you know, decided I needed to back my brother up. So we went, and it was strange. There wasn't a hiccup along the way. Everything went perfect getting to this island, or getting to this village and getting back. We thought it was almost like providence that there was nothing wrong at all, that had we were expecting just a mass of problems. Yeah. We get into Iquitos, we fly into Lima, stay the night, then fly to Iquitos. And Iquitos is the last big town. It's like a 200-year-old town. The guy who built the Eiffel Tower built a building there. Okay. Right. So back in the day, this place was for the rubber plants. So you had a lot of British, a lot of French, a lot of German investors that were there. So that's the originality of Iquitos. It's really cool history.
Yeah.
And so we get there, we meet up with the Apu, Jairo, and he's the chief. And then we meet with a guy who's a government worker at the government building there and at the village. And then we meet up with Christian, the school teacher. And immediately upon talking to them, they all say the same thing. Oh, yeah, these guys are all like, you know, this tall, right? They're huge, 6.5, 7.5 feet tall. And they got these really great big shoes and they fly all over the place and they're terrifying people. And then they said, you know, we've got shotgun snares up everywhere trying to, you know, kill them now. And some people have accidentally been hurt by walking into these shotgun snares.
Mm-hmm.
And which means like there's a shotgun barrel and there's a trip wire and you cross the trip wire and kablooey, right?
Mm-hmm.
Normally this is a hunting tactic that's aimed at about ankle high for the game that's out there that's in mm-hmm. the jungle, not at hip height. And we asked them, why hip height? Why 3 feet off the ground? They said, because they're so big.
Mm-hmm.
And Tim and I are twice the size of any villager.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Easily. So, easily. And they weren't referring to us.
Mm-hmm.
They were referring to something bigger. Okay. Mm-hmm. Stop right there. Did a little bit of research. From the 50s and onward, I have found at least 5 different occurrences now. 2 in Europe, others that are here in America. And that's just you know, a little bit of research, not really too in depth, of these beings being all black or in dark color uniform and being 7 foot tall and menacing. Well, Turns out that's the same thing we were dealing with here at San Antonio de Pintayacu, 7 foot tall and menacing.
Interesting.
So I found that to be very interesting.
Did you find the Vegas descriptions to be similar?
Similar.
Yeah, because I remember I was watching the Vegas thing, and I don't know what you guys came to the conclusion, but I felt there was something going on there. And then I heard about the Peru things, and I'm like, these seem so similar. Just the descriptions of the height and everything.
What I tell people, if you're going to do an investigation like this, is, you know, take your biasness and your opinions and leave it outside of the investigation. Don't let it guide you. When you go to do an investigation, just get the facts of the investigation, who, what, when, where, why, and how, and then start to build those parameters where you see a bunch of the same thing happening. So we're seeing patterns of behavior, patterns in the incident, patterns in the witness testimony. Is there a time gap pattern? Were the dogs barking at every single one of these? Is that a pattern? Was there electrical frequency problems? Is that a pattern? And let that data build and go from case to case to case to case. And you know, you write your narrative of what happened, you hear all the witness testimony, and then you gather the facts. Okay, because if you had to present this to a court, then I want to present facts. I don't want to present to you a story. And that's the way I would do this. That's the way I do investigations, because you're going to be the one who's going to judge, not me. I'm just the one who gathered the facts, who gathered the evidence. My biasness and opinions really shouldn't matter. And that was really our approach going into Peru. We didn't know what to expect. We didn't know if it was freaking aliens, cartel, some crazy guy, a conspiracy. Is this just a ruse to get us out there, right? To get popularity. Because there were so many videos popping up at this time. So many. And then Jairo is on a video and he says, oh yeah, this is definitely aliens. Which, you know, after talking with him, he's like, I should have walked back the whole aliens thing, because I don't know what they are. And none of them know what they are. Too many times did they say, the government said, oh, it's guys with jetpacks. Well, we met with the government. We met with the government. We met with the head of one of their Homeland Security guys, and we met with a retired admiral of the Peruvian Navy. And both good guys, nice guys. They didn't have a good explanation for us. They said, most likely these people aren't seeing what they think that they're seeing.
So of course,
okay.
The typical response from anyone, really.
So I asked. So, you know, I and Timothy, we asked, you know, well, has anyone gone and done an investigation? Nope. Have the local police been out there more than an hour? Nope. Have journalists been out there? Nope. So you're going to sit here and tell me a story that is completely made up, and you're going to expect me to believe it. And I said, Admiral, do you have hovercraft? Well, no. Well, do you have jetpacks? Well, no. And trust me, after reviewing what I saw from the Peruvian Navy, our Coast Guard has 20 times more the assets than the Peruvian Navy. The Peruvian Navy is about as armed as the Texas game wardens are. Right. And the guys that we were with were prior Peruvian Navy, our two security guys. They were awesome. Awesome dudes. They're jungle commandos. Super, super cool guys. But even they said, nah, man, we don't have that gear. And I looked at it and I'm like, this is at any second and third world country I've been in, and I see their law enforcement, I see their military, it's all the same. It's not even within the same shadow of what we at the US use. It's not even close. So it's not those guys. So the thing that I rolled around with enough in my head was, is this the cartel? Because the cartel, at least the Mexican cartel, have our gear. They have our, they have the Pano MVGs. So the quad nods, the four MVGs that you see people wear, those are about $30,000 a piece.
Wow.
And that's government contract only. Okay. So why do you have those in the Sinaloa cartel? Where'd you get RPGs from? Where'd you get American made 50 caliber heavy machine guns from? Or M240 caliber medium machine guns from? Please tell me where you got our grenade launchers from and our mortars from. Well, somebody sold them to somebody. So if somebody sold them to the military of Mexico, and somehow the cartel bought them or took them. Don't you think that somewhere in this game now that we've just created, that there can be technology that you don't know about, that a Fortune 500 company, which means someone who's worth $500 billion or more, would have the ability to buy? Mm-hmm. We're talking about the same group of people who are out in the middle of the Amazon building submarines to put hundreds of millions of dollars worth of narcotics on to float all the way up into America. Yeah. I mean, what can't they do?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The elite own islands. Mm-hmm. We found out while we were there that there was a group of doctors that owned 50 acres 14 days into the Amazon jungle.
Why?
Yeah, for what purpose?
An observatory. It's a scientific observatory. Oh. Hmm. So they take other doctors and scientists out there, and they get to be on this 50 acres, and they get to, you know, experience the jungle. And they got like a little cabana thing built there. And it's for scientific observation, all right? They're probably out there just partying. But if a couple of doctors from America
can do that,
can do that, what can a billionaire do?
Right.
And if a billionaire can do something extraordinarily devious, then what can a $500 billion cartel do, right? Mm-hmm. What couldn't they buy? And who wouldn't sell them stuff? I mean, you know, currently, our weapons that were supposed to be in Ukraine are in the hands of Hamas, flattening tanks right now in Israel. So I start following the evidence and the clues, right? And eventually that leads me to my forethought. I still lean towards some sort of human interaction that these beings are, that with some sort of craft, gear, whatever, technology that we can't explain, that we don't know. I don't know if it's a breakaway civilization. I don't know if it's black budget stuff. All the above, right? Why not? All the above. All I can tell you is, when we got to that village, we were met by over 20 guys armed with shotguns, 16-gauge shotguns. They all had birdshot. Okay, if you wanted to harass a group of people that are very superstitious, that are completely cut off from the rest of the world, I mean, we were 2.5 days up the Amazon River. No one's coming for you. Like, there's not going to be a helicopter coming for you. It's an 8-hour boat ride back to Iquitos. So if there was an actual emergency, it was going to be bad. Well, you know, if it's like that there, what couldn't you get away with the right technology? And if you had this next generation body armor and you're being shot at by birdshot, well, come on, what couldn't you do then? And so that seemed to be the thing that we were monitoring and experiencing, is that these people are getting incursions from humanoid like figures, 6.5 to 7.5 feet tall, completely silent. When they get shot, even shot and knocked down, they don't even make a noise. There's no radio communication. Apparently they do wear some sort of helmet or mask. People there were linking these beings, these people, to the Green Goblin from Spider-Man. And we kind of laughed at that. We're like, you know, that's, and me being an idiot, I'm like, that's probably because these people don't have TV, they don't have internet. And so someone brought a DVD of, you know, Spider-Man, and that's what they're, you know, that's what they're correlating this to. Until you start to talk to people. And once we've, you know, interviewed well over 100 people, everyone says the exact same thing. 6.5 to 7.5 foot tall guys with masks, some sort of backpack, and they're wearing all black. One guy did say that they were wearing silver, but you know, that's an anomalous thing. So they're on some sort of a disc like platform, a circular platform that levitated off the ground, has lights on it, doesn't make a sound until it levitates at a high velocity. But when they're flying around, there's no sound, there's no movement. So that was the most common theme. And here's something that's very interesting, is tell me when this starts to sound human or alien. When these creatures would make these incursions into the village, which, by the way, they burned over 5 acres of triple canopy jungle down to give themselves a barrier between the village and the jungle so they could see them coming. Because the jungle was like right there, right on the village. So they burnt it and cut it all down, Okay. I mean, like, we climbed up on a water tower and we're like, holy crap, man. Like, you leveled a lot.
You can do that for no reason.
Right.
With machetes?
Yeah. Oh, my God.
That's a lot of calories, man.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, there's no bulldozers out there. I mean, they're doing this with machetes and fire.
Yeah.
Okay, so when these things would come in and make an incursion, they would kind of hang out in the tree line, and they would just kind of just sit there and allow themselves to be shot. And then the men would gather and they would close with, and they would approach them and approach and fire. And then these things would just flee. Mm-hmm. They would come in the next day and they'd hang out and they'd get shot at and they'd just flee. That's testing, right?
Mm-hmm.
These are probing patterns. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I thought the fleeing part was a very human aspect. Until you start to think about tactics. All right. If I stay far enough away, your birdshot with my, you know, next generation body armor is probably not going to hurt me. So I'll let the pellets hit me a little bit. And we'll test, you know, what your reaction is.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's a very human thing, at least in my mind. That's a tactical consideration. But there was at least one or two stories of where, you know, guys in the woods and this thing just appears there, appear in front of each other. And he takes a barrel straight to the chest, knocks it down to the ground. And when it hits the ground, it hits and floats and then levitates and raises back up and poof, goes up into the air.
Wow.
And as we're talking to the guy, the guy is just frantic remembering this. He's like, oh, I freaking shot it and it fell on the ground, but it never hit the ground. And he kept saying, it never hit the ground. It raised back up and took off in the air.
Wow.
So
that's insane.
We have, and there are so many different kinds of encounters. These things would, they would be inside the village and they would leap over trees that are 30, 40 feet tall. And they would leap over the houses. They're about 20, 25 feet tall at the highest pitch.
Crazy.
Either on the platforms or not on the platforms. And if they weren't on the platforms, then they have apparently some sort of disc-like devices, two of them on each foot, that allows them to be propelled. And then from there, they could they were described as being very agile. I do remember that. Hiro, the Apu, who is former military, he was saying these guys were very agile. They were fast, they could maneuver, which, you know, it, like, when you think about wearing these types of shoes, I don't understand how you could maneuver just wearing two round discs on your feet.
Mm-hmm.
But they did leave tracks at times.
Interesting.
Yeah, almost about 18 inches is what I measured. Now we didn't
see. Do you have a picture of the tracks?
No, we asked them, like, did anybody take a picture of this?
Right.
We were prepared to collect all different types of evidence while we were there. I brought a whole evidence collection kit. Like, anything that could have happened, I was ready for it, to include any type of DNA samples. Like, we were ready for it.
Wow.
I was like, please let one of these traps hit one of these guys.
Yeah.
Story about the traps. One night, Hiro was saying that these guys were out on patrol. They patrol this village every night. All right.
Now, have they always patrolled it, or is it since the incursions?
Yeah, since the incursions, okay. Which only started like 4 months ago.
Right.
All right. When the men of the village are out and they're patrolling the outer perimeter and inner perimeter of the village, the children, the women, and the elderly will all huddle in the houses in the center of the house.
Mm-hmm.
until daybreak.
Wow.
And we talked to an elderly woman who was, you know, telling us about how she would hear scratching and rattlings, and you could hear things going on, and they kept saying it's a piedacata, it's a piedacata, trying mm-hmm. to break in. But you got to then take a step back and go, is this excited delirium? Is this right. mass psychosis right. possibly? Are you manifesting this within your own mind?
Right.
Because there is a phenomena that's going on.
Right. right.
You know, I mean, when you're scared, you see shadows all over the place and you get right. paranoid, right? Yeah. Common human trait. You have yep. to take that into consideration, that this may also be what we were experiencing and what we were documenting, right? So, and we didn't tell them that because we didn't want to offend them while we were
right.
there.
That's not
what
right.
we were there to do. We weren't there just to dismiss anything that they said.
Right.
We were just there to collect the evidence.
Yep.
But the men would be patrolling, and these things would just appear in the middle of the village. And
out of nowhere.
And, okay, appear in the middle of the village, and you're just going to hop around over a house and look at me hopping over a tree and over a house.
Like, a little ridiculous.
what were you doing? Mm-hmm. Why were you doing it? Richard Dolan said something that has echoed in my mind every single day since being in Peru. We don't know what they're doing or the importance of what they're doing, but it is important to them.
Mm-hmm.
Because yeah. they showed up for 4 months straight and yeah. harassed these people mm-hmm. Continuously. And then you have what happened to Talia.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Talia is the girl who was abducted, kidnapped. Talia was drugged. She has two lacerations on the side of her neck right here.
Right.
They look
and you said
more...
like they spread some kind of numbing cream all over her face.
Yeah, I'll get into that.
Okay.
So we go and talk to Talia. The first day we talked to her, she saw me and Tim, and we were a good healthy 20, 30 feet away from the young lady. Mm-hmm. And then she just started convulsing. She took her hair and hit her face with her hair, and she started convulsing. I've only ever seen that in like people that have had post-traumatic stress. And very dangerous encounters, very deadly like encounters.
Yeah.
Wow. So seeing us triggered something in her mind, and we terrified her. And me and Tim felt so bad about it. I got five kids, Tim's got five kids. Mm-hmm. And I've got three little girls. And so, mm-hmm. you know, as a dad, I'm just sitting here like I'm actually like getting pissed off. Mm-hmm. watching her, because like I'm just like I could only imagine the father
mm-hmm.
felt so bad, like, you know, that's my baby girl, I couldn't mm-hmm. protect her, and now she's terrified, she's messed up in the head, mm-hmm. and I, you know, in my mind I'm like, man, that's a failure of the father, like immediately, not saying that was the father's failure, that's just what it goes into, being a father, being the protector.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, me and Tim were looking at each other like, man, like she's convulsing and walking. And her father, Cecila, really nice guy. He comes out and talks to us. He's like, I'm sorry. She hasn't done this until she saw you two guys.
Mm-hmm.
Because the two guys who tried to take her were two gringos.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when me and Tim went, excuse me?
Right.
Right. Yeah.
7.5 foot tall aliens bounding right. over
yeah.
gringos.
Right.
And so yeah. that's when the investigation took a turn.
Mm-hmm.
And so before this, you know, we're talking about Silver Surfer, you know, the, mm-hmm. the Green Goblin. We're talking about guys with jetpacks and yeah. hoverboards and who knows. And then all of a sudden this took a very sinister human turn.
Mm. Human Interesting. Turn.
So the next day, because we only had 3 days in this village, it mm-hmm. cost a lot of money, by the way, to get this done. So the church that's in Tennessee that helped us fund this whole thing, you know, God bless you guys if you ever listen to this.
Mm-hmm.
But we wouldn't have been able to do that without them. Like this mm-hmm. this cost, you know, $20,000 just to get this done.
Oh my word. Are you serious?
I believe it. Costs
a lot of money to get down there and get all this done. And you know, Tim and I can't afford to do that. So
right.
You know, this was a mission. God provided the money. Mm-hmm. We're there to collect evidence, and we brought food and brought medicine. And we brought technology. So there's the humanitarian thing. The reason why we brought the food, the medicine, and the technology is that whatever was happening was in such frequency and so disturbing to these people that they would not go to the Conchas, which was out in the jungle where they had their, you know, their ancient farming lands. They wouldn't go to the rivers, into the inlets where they had, they would collect the fish, because what they grew and what they caught is what they ate. These are very poor people. It's one of the poorest places in the world. Mm. It's like literally one of the most impoverished places alone in South America.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, when we come there with a lot of money's worth of goods, these people were ecstatic because they were literally thriving off of what they had been storing up over the last couple months. Because they would not go out at night. They wouldn't go out during the day. And the men wouldn't leave the village. Because when the men left the village, something happened. And so the way it was described to us through Hiro, the Apu, is that, you know, like, there's a building over here that has the last bit of food that we have. They were running out of food.
Wow.
Okay. So for anyone to say that Tim and I are grifters, which I don't know these words that kids make up now. I don't know what grifter means. Poser is what it used to be for all those cool kids in the 90s.
Yes. Yes.
But it
anyone who does anything in this field is a grifter nowadays. So don't worry about it.
Yeah. Says the guy in his grandma's basement typing you know, on his computer, bunch of grifters. It quickly turned into a humanitarian thing. A few days before we had gotten to the village, there was a young man who was bitten by a fertilance viper, almost died.
Those are deadly, right?
Yeah, it's like the number two most deadliest snake in South America.
Oh my gosh.
And they're all over the place. And these people are walking around barefoot or in flip-flops. Okay. You know, Americans don't understand poverty. I'm gonna say this and then get off of my high horse. You do not understand poverty like these people, but they thrived in it. They thrived in it. So what, you know, I'm putting together a video right now with what Tim made, was more about the debrief. I'm putting together a video that'll be on my website, on my YouTube and Rumble channel. And it involves all the other footage of what we were doing there. Because
I can't wait to see that.
Yeah. We wanted to focus on the investment that Tim had put into this. And the time that he put, Tim spent so much time putting all this together. And like this whole thing would not have been possible without a Timothy Alberino. Like it just wouldn't have been done. Tim was the guy for this time and he blew it out of the park. I was very impressed with Tim the entire time we were there. And I've been on, just in law enforcement alone, hundreds of missions. Within the military, I've probably done a couple thousand missions altogether. And so I've done quite a bit of things and I've led quite a bit of things. And this was one of the most well-organized events that I've ever been on. And so, you know, my hat's off to Tim. He really blew this out of the park. That being said, we were still quite taken off guard by Talia.
Yeah.
And it freaked us out. Like after we had that initial conversation with Cecilia and with Hiro about Talia, because we were going to interview her the second day. We had to push it back to our third day, the last day. And we've got all of our witness stuff done for that day. That night, the second night, I was teaching this big class on gun safety, because my Lord, did they need it? And then how to use the technology and how to use the radios and how to patrol. That's another part of the humanitarian thing, was how to teach these guys how to actually be in a uniform patrol so that they wouldn't shoot each other, because in the past they had shot each other. Okay. So a little bit of training increased the safety, which if we're going to be out there with you, I want to be able to control the chaos.
Right. Yeah.
And when we leave, we want you to be able to do this successfully.
Yeah.
Because what we want to see is them catch one of these guys. Yep. That's what we want to see. They're probably not going to live, but we want to see them catch one of these guys, because these guys have a little bit of payback that they want to put down.
Yeah.
But we have... walk back to the boat. Go ahead.
Oh, no. I just wanted, Talia, did she, do you think it was the same thing that she experienced?
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, you do? Mm-hmm. Okay. The way you said the gringos, it made me wonder, was there some other entity or person or something involved that
it could, you don't think it could have been two completely separate events, that these there were just two guys that were just on a kidnapping mission that had nothing to do with the Pelicaras, or you know,
you were going to kidnap anybody, you would go to Lima, you would go to Nauta, well, maybe not Nauta, but you would go to Lima, or you go to Iquitos, and you'd wait at the bar.
Yeah.
That's what you do. You'd wait for some dumb gringo. You get all liquored up, or slip them some narcotics, and there's your kidnapping victim. There's your organ harvesting. It can all be done right there.
Yeah.
But why you go 35 miles as the crow flies into the densest, most dangerous jungle in the world?
Yeah.
To kidnap somebody from a village of all armed men with shotguns.
Yeah.
Why?
Yeah.
Like, why did stay in Lima?
Yeah.
There's plenty of people in Lima. I mean, like this was not the place you would do that.
And that was another question that I had for you, is do you have any theories of why this village, why Peru? I mean, out of all the places in the world, you know, this is obviously centered. And I know you said that you've maybe tracked some instances down of this similar thing happening in other places in the world. But for now, it, you know, this phenomenon has chosen, and there's always a reason. Like you said, you don't believe in coincidence. So there's obviously a reason why this specific village was targeted.
This is still a phenomenon within itself. Tim nor I can find any type of evidence that talks about guys floating around on disc peeling people's faces off. Like, this is a local phenomenon. Okay. The whole face peeling thing is only 40 or 50 years old.
Okay.
Interesting to know, and I don't know how much I believe it, but one of the elders of the village says, I remember when I was a little boy and this was happening, and they flew in on paragliders. Guys in all black, and they would rip people's faces off. But once again, where are you going to land it? There's not a landing zone. You're going to impale yourself in the tops of trees with thorns the size of my freaking fist. It's not going to work. So I don't know where you would land unless right on the water. The thing about these, go ahead.
She mentioned, you mentioned that they spoke to her. I wanted you to talk about that, because I thought that was interesting, the different language. And then my curiosity is, was it verbal or was it telepathic?
So for one thing, I don't know if it's verbal or telepathic.
Okay.
We're taking a witness testimony from a frightened girl at night, who was, you know, ambushed. So I don't know exactly, but she said she heard distinct profiles within their voices. She heard one who spoke perfect Peruvian Spanish and one who spoke broken Spanish, which she called gringo. The Peruvian was a shorter guy, like Peruvians are, and then the gringo was 6.5 to 7 feet tall.
What the hell?
Okay, which now we have some anomalies. Okay, so Talia is the first one within who knows how many incursions to say that they spoke.
Right.
Talia is the first one in how many incursions to say that one of the guys was short. Okay, so I'll come back and tell you that during the heat of the moment, you're going to get tunnel vision.
Oh, yeah.
You're going to get what we call audio and visual exclusion. You're not going to hear everything. You're not going to see everything.
Yeah.
And you'll have to do some serious memory recall in order to deprogram that event and drag that event back out of the darkness of your mind. That's what we do with officers after any type of shooting or violent encounter. We give them days to work on that. And then, you know, sometimes our incident reports can be updated a month or two or 6 months or a year later when an officer can say, hey, I just something happened. And I remember this event. I saw this as well. I need to go and update that report. So what Talia saw, if I had the ability, I would continue to question her a month or two from now to see if she recalls anything else. But she was so physically disturbed with us being around her. And you'll see in the video, I mean, the cross-eyed look that she would give me, it made me nervous. Like I've only ever been looked at like that by dogs, by like a dog that is like, I'm about to come and bite you.
Oh
like,
my God.
She looked at me with pure malice.
Wow.
And you can, and a 14, 15 year old girl don't do that.
Right. So
something. And she would look at, she'd look at Tim like that. And I was just like, Tim, you might want to take a couple steps back. And I always, I always stayed away from her at least 10 feet. Not only that, but because the equipment, the audio, but I felt like even being that close to her was what safety bubble. And so we were able to actually break that barrier down when we prayed with her. We both, you know, put our hands on her and we prayed with her. And she alleviated a little bit. She, you know, I mean, you gotta understand, like being kidnapped, she was drug out of her backyard. These guys immediately, they started working on her. They were holding a hand over her mouth. Another guy was preparing some sort of a nasal syringe to inject narcotics, which I'll talk about why all of that doesn't make sense. But then another guy puts this stuff on her face that came out of like a big white tube. Doesn't sound very alien to me. And she heard the gringo, or no, she heard the Peruvian. This is what we call the two guys, the gringo and the Peruvian. She heard the Peruvian tell the gringo, don't apply too much to her face. You'll ruin the flesh. You'll ruin the meat. The original translation was meat. We determined that she was talking about flesh. Immediately upon putting this on her face started to swell up. So something evidently opened all the capillaries in the face and drew all the blood into the face. And that's why her face swelled up. I don't know what the significance of the face is, but I know that blood is used in occultism. People wear people's faces because of occultism.
Yeah.
I don't know why a gray alien would need that. Not to say that they wouldn't, right? But immediately, this is my mind going back as an investigator. This is what occultists do, okay? So if you were some sort of advanced species on some sort of advanced craft, you're wearing bullet-resistant gear, why did you struggle with a 100-pound, 14-year-old Peruvian girl? And not only that, when they dropped her, she started to raise, hit this one guy, the gringo, who was holding her behind her, her back like this. She was able to raise his mask, his helmet. She was able to hit it and actually detach it from his face and raise it. And that's when the Peruvian smacked the living crap out of her.
Did she see like human skin?
No, it's all, it's dark. And okay. Not only is dark, but she's being held like this.
Right.
Right. And so she can't really see. She's just struggling.
I see.
Screaming, struggling. Yeah. But she said, I felt it move. I grabbed the mask and I felt it move. And that's mm-hmm. when she got the crap smacked out of her. Very human-like trait. Right. Right?
Yeah.
That does not.
So
yeah.
She's struggling too much. And so the gringo tells the Peruvian to apply whatever. And he pulls out a liquid in one hand and powder in the other and mixes the two together, puts it in. Originally, it was a stick. But come to find out after actually talking with her, it was a nasal syringe.
Mm-hmm.
They drew it out and injected it into her nose. Oh. Okay. So that means that narcotics go straight to the brain. Right.
Yep.
Right into the system.
Yep.
I mean, the only other closest way that you could do that is to inject right into the eyeball. That's what they used to do with LSD. Right. For mind control. Okay.
Yeah.
So this numbed her face, brought all the blood to the face. They, for whatever reason, didn't have this syringe already pre-prepared. Like, why wouldn't you have it pre-prepared already? Kind of piss poor planning if this is military guys. And not only mm-hmm. that, here's another interesting thing, is that they only made incursions into the village at dusk and dawn. Dusk and dawn. Not at midnight when everyone's asleep. Not at 3 a.m. after everyone's drunk on Masato, which is terrible.
Sorry about that.
Yeah,
I asked buddies of mine that are special operations for the military, and I said, listen, man, if I said I want you to go into a village and I want you to go and kidnap a girl,
mm-hmm.
just you and your buddy, and I'm gonna give you all this equipment, what time are you gonna go? I don't know, 3 a.m. 3:30?
Yeah,
because we own the night.
Mm-hmm.
That's our night vision. That's how we operate. That's when we did it in Iraq. Okay. So why would you only hit at dusk and dawn? Everybody's either awake or waking.
Mm-hmm. So you're thinking some kind of like ritualistic reason?
I have no idea. No, I have no idea.
Yeah.
We have, look, the
anomalous compared to what a rational.
It's anomalous.
Yeah.
It's not tactical. It's anomalous. So at one minute we're saying this is definitely people. And then another minute we're saying, how could you be so terrible at this?
Yeah.
You know, you're 6.5 to 7 foot tall, you're on floating disc, you're bulletproof. You mm-hmm. don't even know to make the narcotic syringe. You had to slap the girl because you can't maintain control of her. And then mm-hmm. when they drop her, the gringo says, hey, we can't leave her here. So he grabs her by the hair and proceeds to pull her up this hill. Now, we don't know yet if he was trying to levitate off the ground with her
mm-hmm.
and take her, or if it was to hide her body.
Mm-hmm.
At some point during this struggle is when they attempted to make the lacerations on the neck.
Mm-hmm.
You'll see in the video that the lacerations on the neck are not bleeding.
Mm-hmm.
And this was taken the night of. Mm-hmm. It's not bleeding, okay? I grew up on a cattle ranch. I know how to dress out cows and deers and hogs, and I got all the cool knives for it. And when you make an incision into the body, you're going to see the flesh and fat separate, and you're going to see blood. That's not what we saw. We saw burn marks.
Mm.
You see two distinct burn marks. And go back to the cattle mutilation story I told you. My vet tech, he told me that the way they took the ears and the genitalia off, at least on our steer, was they did it with, I think he called it a laser knife or a laser scalpel, some sort of superheated knife. It's not a very big instrument, and it has just a little battery pack.
Kind of like a cauterization tool, right?
Exactly.
Yep.
Okay, so quick question then. There are so many stories of abductees coming back with implants in them. Are we sure they weren't trying to chip her or put some sort of an implant in her? Like, are you sure they were trying to peel off her face, or could there have been a different agenda there?
As far as we know, it was for the face, because that's what the applicator was for. Okay. That's the conversation that she overheard.
Okay.
Oh, you're wearing the flesh. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Now, I don't know how you overhear a telekinetic conversation or a telepathic conversation. I've heard different people say maybe because she was in close proximity.
Right.
It bled over into her brain. Yeah. Maybe so. All I can tell you is that is what she's saying. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't mean that I believe 100%, but that is just what the testimony says.
Timothy Alberino talks a lot about screen memories too. Could those have been implanted screen memories?
No, that's another thing. That's not what this is not what the Grays do. Okay. Now I'm not an expert on the Grays. That's Tim, but from Tim and I talked about this quite a bit. Okay. We had many cigars over this conversation.
Yeah.
And this is not their MO. Supposedly the way Tim makes this out is that if the Grays wanted to, they're just going to take you. They could put that whole village asleep and take the entire village and then reinsert them and no one would be the wiser. But this was such a violent encounter. Mm-hmm. You know, she's out there, she's by the tree, she's picking fruit, and this guy comes up the hill. Like, so I'm going to draw this, right? This is the backyard, slopes like this, and here's the tree. This guy just levitates up, grabs her, and starts to pull her back, and out of nowhere, another guy comes and grabs her feet. They go behind the chicken coop, which is about 30 to 40 feet downward behind this fruit tree into like a little gully, and the gully goes like this and goes back uphill, surrounded by houses. This is the area where this happened at. There's like four or five houses in a circle. All armed men. Like, do you know how brazen you got to be?
Right.
To say, hey, we're going to go to this backyard and take this one random teenage girl and probably be surrounded and shot at close range.
Right.
You know, like that's bad tactics. That's not good tactics. So she's screaming, they drop her, the gringo's dragging her by the hair, he drops her again, and for whatever reason everyone's starting to come out now. The older brother comes out, he's the first one to discover it because he's hearing her scream. Then the other neighbors who are actually in closer proximity come out, and they all see these guys, two of them, and they're wearing all black on the disc. And they go to the one area in this gully where there's a clearing, there's no trees, and one at a time, poof, poof, and they take off. Never a dematerializing or stepping into a portal. It is a mechanical thing that they're standing on, and they take off on. Here's one interesting thing that Talia told us. Talia said that they had some sort of body armor on. And Tim and I, we kind of disagree a little bit on this, but that's just because we just don't have enough information, and we're trying to create in our minds what it is that she was describing. So either of us could be right or wrong. It sounded like they were wearing motocross gear. She said
that there was
sort of a triangular plate, metal plate like thing. I don't know if she's ever seen motocross gear, but they have hard plastic plates right here as the chest protector.
Or
a hard foam as a chest protector. She said that there was some sort of armor on the forearms and on the shins. And immediately I'm like, BMX gear, motocross gear, right?
Yeah.
And then she said, when the guy came and grabbed her at the fruit tree, the disc platform sat down on the ground. He grabbed her, he touched something on his ankle, and it levitated back up off the ground and then took off. So
weird.
What a mechanical human-like function that where I step in on the platform with my feet, I go clink, clink, the platform's now engaged because I apparently am carrying the energy in the backpack. This is what we're thinking, right? The backpack is the fuel cell, whatever it is on the feet, doesn't have enough thrust, so the disc platform provides more thrust, and you activate it by pressing something on the side of your boot. Mm-hmm. Now, we don't know if both of them were trying to take her up into the air. It just seemed to be such a commotion and happened so quickly that they just didn't get to that.
Yeah.
Right. And
has there been any successful face peeling events? That sounds so terrible to successful. Or that in that area.
So in this area recently, no. Probably 2 or 3 weeks prior to us getting there, we didn't know about this. But while we were visiting the city of Nalta, which is a place where we think we observed a gray alien that was up in a tree.
Mm-hmm.
But that's what we think, all right, based off the video footage. And everyone who's seen the video footage sees the eyes. So,
or an insectolin.
Right, yeah. Right. And for me, I don't know what the difference between an insectolin and a gray is because I've never seen one. Mm-hmm. So all I can say is there's something there turning its head, mm-hmm. and you can even see the eyes shine. Now,
and you guys captured that one?
Yeah. Well, no, this was cell phone video footage. We tried to talk to the guy who recorded it, but he didn't want to be on video.
Okay.
So did he talk off the record?
No, absolutely refused.
Hmm. Yeah, interesting.
Absolutely refused. But we were right there in the area where all these homes are.
Mm-hmm.
And we saw it. But while we were in Nalta, we were told of a story of about a 12 to 13 year old boy who was abducted. Was found, and half of his face from about right here above the ear to all the way under the jaw was completely lacerated.
Gosh, that's terrifying.
And that it was apparently a very bloody mess. Oh. And that poor boy is going to be messed up for the rest of his life for that. So, we forget a lot of times about the victims. Mm-hmm. Talia, this boy. Talia was sent down the river to another village to be examined by a doctor, and we have the papers where it says that she has like severe PTSD. And so Tim paid for her and her father to go to Iquitos to go and see a psychologist because they couldn't afford it.
That's so amazing.
Out of his pocket, man, right there. Nope, we're paying for it. You're going to go there.
I'm so glad to hear that.
Yeah, I mean, this like we said, man, it was definitely a humanitarian mission. Like, upon boots on the ground and talking with people, we're like, all right, we're not here to investigate, Mary Sue and Billy Bob's, cow in the back. There's something very nefarious happening that's freaking these people out.
Mm-hmm.
For 20 to 30 or more grown men to be legitimately worried.
Mm-hmm.
To carrying their guns 24/7, fearing for their children, fearing for their wives, fearing for the elders. Something had to be happening.
Mm-hmm.
People could say it was an experiment. I don't know. People could say it was an alien. I don't know. Was it the cartel? I don't know. That's what we are here to tell you is we don't know.
Yeah.
We don't know. Wish we could have stayed longer. Didn't have the ability to. Yeah. I'm sure eventually we're going to go back. Hopefully I can bypass the Masato. We don't need to do that anymore. We're friends now.
Yeah, we're friends. We did it the one time. We're good.
But in Nalta, 55 miles away from Iquitos. San Antonio de Pinzayacu, 35 miles away from Iquitos. And it's like 65 miles from San Antonio de Pinzayacu to Nalta. They're having the same incursions. All right, so what were the stories? The stories were that illegal miners, illegal gold miners, illegal timber foresters are trying to scare these people off the land. Mm-hmm. No, they're not. There is so much land. There is so much land. That's just stupid. When you go out there and you go like, man, we've traveled up this river for like 2 days and we've saw maybe 10 people. Like, there's enough out here, right?
Yeah.
So it wasn't that. And if it was that, then why is the same thing happening in this little bitty village of 200 people or less happening in Nauta, a city of 30,000 people. The same thing, the same phenomena, the same guys in an area where you have the military with automatic weapons, high caliber weapons. Now, I asked my same buddy this question, my special operations guy. I said, okay, so this one village, 16 gauge birdshot. Not too worried about that, right? Because we got this cool technology that we can just make up any story that we want to with it. But would you want to get shot by a 308 multiple times? You know, a bullet about that big? Would you want to get shot, you know, by an AK-47? And he's like, absolutely not. I said, neither would I.
No matter what kind of body armor you have on.
Yeah, yeah, no thanks, right?
The technology is just, like, that part is just mind-blowing to me. I actually have this guy that flies around our neighborhood. I don't understand. In one of those, is it a paraglide jetpack thing? It has the paraglide thing over, but he flies around in the neighborhood. And, I mean, it's loud. You can hear it.
Is he sitting in it that's got a big fan behind him?
It's, I don't know. It's, but it's got the big, you know, umbrella over it, and it's, you could hear it, and he hovers around the neighborhood. You see that thing coming. It's loud. He can't land. He can't.
You see how vulnerable someone would be with a parachute over them?
Yeah. I mean, I just don't understand how this technology exists.
Well, yeah, because if let's say in Nauta, where they're still doing the same thing. And they're not at the outskirts. Where we were at was in almost the middle of a suburban area.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. And they're still appearing. And they're still kidnapping people. And the police doesn't believe it. The military doesn't believe it. But it's still happening. Those people in that area were still doing their own patrols in their own neighborhood. Because of the frequency. And they said it's been happening for months. It started in San Antonio, and then it moved to Nauta. And then while we were there, we heard that it was happening in Terrapoto, which is like a couple hundred miles or a day away up in the mountains, because we were in the rainforest, and this is and in the Amazon, and where Terrapoto is over there in the mountain area. So it's happening in strange frequencies all around Peru. And we don't know if it's happening in Colombia and in Argentina and Brazil, but there's plenty of UFO stories about all that.
Right.
You know, you had the UFOs in Brazil that were hunting down people and killing people. So, you know, and the whole Facebook thing, we were told stories that, you know, back in the day, they were abducting people. They were organ harvesting people, mutilating people. And now they're just at their faces. So, and this is one thing that we were kind of talking about, like, why would you go to a village of armed people when you could just take that, you know, one guy in his wooden canoe and his dugout canoe floating in one of these little lakes or tributaries, take that guy.
Right.
He's armed with a treble hook.
Yeah.
You know what? Why a village full of armed people? And if you're going to go there and you do it one or two days just to screw with them, sure, whatever. But months?
Yeah.
None of this makes sense. And that's what we're trying to tell the audience, is like, we don't have any solids to go on. I mean, like,
it's even more mysterious situation. The more you know, the more you know about it, the more insane it sounds, honestly.
Yep.
Yeah, the more we know about it, the more I go, this is not special operations. So for all those people who go out there and say, oh, this is our special operations, no, it's not, man. Because I know the gear our guys carry. I know what they're going to be doing, and I know our guys aren't going to go into a random village without their pistols or rifles or a plate carrier or a helmet or radio communication. All right, and anyone who was actually in the military and anyone who was actually in special operations would probably back me up when I say that. For all the keyboard warriors who know absolutely nothing, look, I get it. You're distrusting of the U.S. government. So are we. Don't think we didn't think every day we were there, we're like, man, is someone watching us?
Like,
are we going to get a high-powered flashlight in the face, you know, on this houseboat that we're staying at in the middle of the night? There was a point in time where, like, if this is narcos, we're disturbing them, they're gonna waylay us on the way back. Or if it's the deep state government and we find something, what do we do? Do they know that we know that they know? And like the paranoia,
you start going down that rabbit hole for
sure.
Like the paranoia.
I go down that rabbit hole myself, just doing a podcast, you know, just seriously, just wondering, like, what is it? Who, what are these things? And if it is, if what I'm seeing is secret military, black ops, you know, technology, I still have the same concerns.
It's concerning. It's concerning no matter what. That's for darn sure. Well, should we start? Should we start wrapping up then, Krys?
I think so.
Doug, you are one.
Doug, this is great.
I know you're one special fella. We've never gone over an hour and 20 minutes, so you're our first. We hit the 2 hour mark with Doug. Yes.
This has been good. No, it's been a really interesting analysis. That's what I feel like it's been. Like, I've really seen and heard your full analysis of, like, what made you come to these conclusions. It's just so bizarre. I can't even.
I want to say something to clear the air. My analysis and my opinions are mine. Doesn't make me right. Doesn't make me right. My sarcastic opinions about other people's opinions, if they hurt your feelings, you can contact Ariel and you can contact Krys.
Oh gosh, thanks very much.
Krys needs to understand more about the flat earth biblical cosmology. Please direct all opinions towards her.
It's so funny you say that, because one of my girlfriends mentioned something about homeschooling and flat earth, and I just didn't make the connection that she was referring to Christians homeschooling and flat earth, and I just blew it off. But now I'm like, she knows more about this than me, so
you'll have to go explore that.
That's all I can say is Jesus loves you. This is the breakdown of our investigation. We went there, we did what we said we were going to do.
Yep.
We were totally shocked by our own conclusions when we did the initial conversation about it. It was about face peelers.
Mm-hmm.
When we left, it's still about face peelers.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
That's it.
Yeah. I it's a phenomena. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's probably still occurring. I don't know the frequency. We're in contact with the village. With the technology that we gave them, they have the ability to record these things at night, hopefully communicate better, hopefully be more safe. We got to pray over the village. We got to pray with the people. We got to pray over Talia. So we brought the gospel down there to them, and we came back with our faces and not with malaria. So on to the next adventure.
Well, thank you so much for coming on and giving your time and talking with us. This has been a really long time coming, I feel like, because I have wanted to talk to you for so long. And so thank you so much. Tell everybody where we can find you, where they can find you.
So you can listen to the American Vindictive Show podcast at gsradio.net, 6 to 7 p.m. Eastern time frame. It'll be playing. If not, no longer Amazon, but YouTube and Rumble. I only have two strikes right now on YouTube, so I think they fall off here in like a couple days. Well, I've had like seven strikes against me. I get like two strikes, and then I wait a couple months for one to drop off, and I pick up another one. So I have like frequent flyer miles.
I don't know what the strikes are for. I'm always afraid, like, Am I supposed to cut this cuss word out? Are they gonna ban my
video? I know what the strikes are for. The strikes are for the simple reason that I don't care. I don't care who's I'm not here. I don't get friendship pay to do this. I'm not here for your feelings. So if I hurt your feelings, YouTube, sorry. I'm gonna swallow some rocks. Ladies, thank you so much for inviting me on. Thank you very much.
This has been really cool, and I'm glad Ariel knew you, and we had an opportunity to hear the story. And tell Timothy thank you as well, because obviously this was both of your journey and your efforts and your whole team that went out there. And by the way, thank you for your service. I'm a fellow corpsman, and I know we're not considered much unless we're corpsmen, so semper fi.
Yep. By the way, they don't know me personally, but I reached out to the Blurry Creatures podcast guys, and I mean, they just have no clue who I am. I was just some person who emailed them, but I asked them when their next Blurry Con is going to be, and they said they're hoping for the fall. So I'm going to try and be there, and you better try and go, Doug, so then I can finally meet you in person.
We'll try and be there.
Wouldn't that be fun?
Oh, yeah, that'll be fun. There'll be plenty of more exciting things to come here in the next coming months and weeks, I'm sure.
I believe it.
Oh, yeah. Awesome.
Well, thank you so much. All right, guys.
See you later, Doug.
Bye.
See you, ladies. Bye.
Thank you again. Take care.